What's up, everybody? Simon here. Today I'm gonna do a video that's been kind of long awaited with my Model X. I've put on over 5,000 miles on this vehicle, and if we take a look here on the screen, actually 6,243 miles to date. So this is my review of the first 5,000 or 6,000 miles impression, and whether or not you should get this vehicle for your family, yourself. Tesla is basically becoming a big company. The stocks are doing great. More people are coming into the realm of actually having an electric vehicle. And this video kind of goes over my in-depth review of all of the menu here, as well as owning this vehicle for the first 5,000 or 6,000 miles. So before I get into this video, go ahead, hit the like button and subscribe to my channel. As always, I appreciate it. Check out my buying experience videos as well. It's in the link below. Let's get into this video. Okay, so first, Tesla is a great vehicle to have. I personally have a $120,000 Range Rover that's supercharged V8 with a custom exhaust. You could check out that review as well, maybe on this side of the screen. And that car is amazing. But every time I sit in my $120,000 Range Rover, I feel like it's outdated. It's no longer valuable. It's no longer fun to drive. I don't even want to drive because this thing is so convenient. It has everything you need, and it has this technology that is unmatched. When I sit inside the Range Rover, I feel like I'm sitting inside almost a dinosaur type technology, even though it has two big screens and so forth. And you can check out that video on that Range Rover that I did as well. But this Tesla just does so much more than any other car out there, including drive itself. So it's not perfect, however. So let's go into kind of what the Model X has. The difference between the Model X is you have this big screen here, and then there's an additional screen on this side. And this screen gives you your mileage and your autopilot or full self-driving. The lever here on this enables your full self-driving by double tapping it. Let's go over the screen here. You get this gigantic screen. All of your controls are here. When you click on the car, you go into your car settings. You can set your exterior lights. I usually set it to auto, your fog lights. You can fold your mirrors. These doors, you press it, and basically it opens your Falcon Wing doors. So that's convenient. When the kids get into the car, you got a opportunity to open the doors for them easily. And I personally like that, and it's a good feature. So then you could also open, check this out, by pressing here, you can open the passenger door. So if my wife's getting in with some coffee, which she does once in a blue moon, I can open the door for her without having to reach through, and it shows that I am still chivalrous. So chivalry is not dead, especially with the Tesla. You could open the door for her, and you could close it at the same time. What's neat is you could open the frunk and the trunk. You could close all the doors. So even if I open my door, her door, so I have all the doors open here, as you could see. I could even open the trunk by pressing the trunk button, and now the trunk is opening. So let's look to the back. You kind of have everything exposed. The Falcon Wing doors just give this so much room of ease of access, and they open in very tight spots as well because there's sensors and cameras. But going ahead and just having everything here, you could see that with one button press, I'm able to close everything. So there it goes. And it just closed just like that. So now everything's closed. On here, you have your seats. So you could actually push by pressing this button, it'll move the middle row back. So now it's in position to go back, and it's locked in or latched in. So for ease of access, you could control the seats. Really neat. Suspension in this screen. It tells you how your suspension is, basically. I usually set it to low ride, and it allows it to be more centered to the ground because of the heavy batteries underneath, which you can see here, take turns a little bit faster. So I always set it to low, and when I need to get out of a driveway because I have a tow hitch or anything like that, I quickly switch it to high, and it enables it a pretty fast switch. So that's incredible, guys, okay? Suspension, you could also set it to auto, comfort, or sport. Sport's gonna make it very stiff, so you could take corners. Comfort, it's more damp. And then you got advanced settings, which I don't mess with, but I usually leave it on auto. lights. You got auto on your lights, your dome light, you could turn it on and it's actually right here. So pretty nice. And there is a little dome light in the back as well. So you could see it back there. And I usually set it to auto in the function here. Auto high beam, that's nice. It'll turn off your high beam. Driving modes, I do standard, so the accelerator works really good. Steering, I do standard. You could do a stiffer steering. Stopping mode, this is interesting. In a traditional car, guys, you're holding your brake pedal. Well, you don't need to hold your brake pedal here. The car comes to a stop, you could let go. Your foot doesn't need to be on the gas or brake or anything, and it creeps to a stop, which is pretty nice. Slip start is for snow and mud, and then trailer mode if you have a trailer, if you're towing something. So that's pretty neat. Autopilot, this is where it gets interesting. So when I first got the car, a lot of these features on autopilot, which you could see here, were disabled. I had to enable all of them. So auto steer, navigate on autopilot means that I enter an address in the navigation menu and it's gonna navigate that on autopilot, which is pretty neat. So you got that setting here, and it will take the freeway exit for you, and we'll get to see that in a bit. Then you got your traffic light, stop and stoplight and sign control. So honestly, it's not a full self-driving car. There are issues. You have to hold on to the steering wheel and make sure that you're able to stop, because it will prevent you from, it may not take the turn correctly and so forth. So you still have to be alert. So it's not like you enter an address and then you go and you get to the destination without driving once. Even though they say it's full self-driving, it's not there yet. Green light chime. I love this feature, and you could, you know, it tells you what's happening. I feel like there's a camera here in the Tesla. Every time I'm looking down, let's say on my phone at a stoplight, or I'm looking away or whatever, it'll chime and it'll go boom on a green light. It alerts me that we need to move forward, or I need to step on the gas pedal or whatever. So, you know, summon, this feature is, I haven't tested it yet and it's not part of this video, but basically if I'm in a parking lot like this parking lot here today, and I'm in a puddle or I'm in rain and I'm standing, let's say, over there, it's going to back up and it's going to come to me and pick me up, and I will be able to get into the car. Speed offset, this is neat. So I actually like it 15% higher than what's the allowed speed. Speed limit warning, I want to display, I don't want it to chime to bug me. And then speed, I do relative plus 10 miles an hour. Then you could scroll up. Collision warnings, I like it early, especially if you're on autopilot. You got lane departure, I do an assist, so it puts you back in the lane. And then blind spot collision warning, this saved me one time. I was getting on the freeway, went far left, and the cameras detected a car on the left side, and then went beep, 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 and I quickly went into my lane. So I love that. The car has a lot of storage here. I have my sanitizers, masks, and it goes deep inside. It also closes by one port press, and then gives you this nice wood feel. There's a little storage here as well for your compartment. This is a charger, wireless charger, and this thing does close up as well, like so. So you could get a pretty good amount of storage in here, and then cup holders. Let's get back to the screen here, guys. So with the screen, you also have the vehicle. This is pretty neat. Automatic doors, they open when you come in or come close to it. Close all with the key fob, you could play with it. Falcon door height, it's on auto, so it knows when to open. Walk away door lock, you can set it to on, but then you could also make sure it doesn't lock when you're at home. So that's pretty neat, so you could get back in the car. Now the car can open with your Tesla app, and you could actually unlock the car to drive with your Tesla app, but it's not automatic like it's on the Model 3 and the Model Y. Child protection locks, so they can't open the door. Driver door unlock mode, basically it unlocks the driver door only when you shift to park. That's pretty neat, and if you're in a sketchy area. Car left open notifications, these are cool, saved me from a rainy day. Had my window a little bit open, and you get a text message. Mirror tilt, auto wipers, lots of other things. When you first get into the car, you really need to make sure that you have setting here so that your key fob is recognized. And I think it's in the safety and security mode, but passive entry, that's what you need on. Otherwise, it's as if you need to unlock the car with your key fob. And that was something that was not set as default. So you got to turn that on to make sure you got wireless key entry. Display, just brightness and hours and so forth, not really fun. Trips, it tells you how much power I've used navigation, and you could, this is pretty just like an odometer that you normally have back there, how long your trip is, how much power you use and distance and so forth. Navigation, really neat. So automatic navigation, so it knows where you might be going. It kind of plans your trip. Trip planner has supercharger. So let's say if I'm going to Lake Tahoe, guys, it's going to know that you need to stop by a supercharger on the way over there. We haven't had a chance to do that yet, but I would record that if it happened. Sentry mode, this is if you want to record your camera. While you're parked, you have to plug in a USB. Joe mode, I think it reduces the volume of your car's chime. So that's something that they recommended and they named it after. Pretty cool. Glove box protection, like valet mode and so forth. Cabin overheat protection. And then there's data sharing. Service, so towing, wheel configuration. So, you know, I need to configure that. I set for 22-inch wheels, and I'm going to confirm it, and it's going to reboot the configuration. There's other configuration modes here for driving, so, and now it's rebooted. So once I configured it, check it out, guys, everything got rebooted. Okay, so now it's rebooted, as you guys could tell, and it just turned back on. So that's pretty much it. So if I press the steering, the brakes, it turns the car on and it allows me to move. I'm gonna push it back into park mode and it's gonna turn that chime off, but it rebooted. So once it reboots, we go back to the system here. And even though I selected the 22 inch, it still tells me I have the same amount of mileage. Here you get your mileage, which position of vehicle you're in, drive or so forth. You have your song being played in the background, I'll mute it. Here's a trick, if you hold this wheel, you could go into a lot of different programs here, including check your tire pressure. That's where a big one is that a lot of people don't know. Where's the tire pressure? You could adjust the climate, turn off the climate. I'll turn it off for now. And that's pretty much what you got here. So I'll switch it back to say media, which is makes the most sense. You have your speed here, your timer that you could actually select what you choose. Here on the steering wheel, you have your volume up and down. And then you have your previous and next song on this side, your voice commands, and more settings, recent calls, fan speed, display brightness, and pretty much it. So that's kind of what that is. All right. So pretty simple. You have your drive. This looks like it's out of a Mercedes-Benz. Your reverse, neutral, and then your park, which is this button here. On this side, you have your turn signal, and then your wipers. You could press to wipe once. And then pretty much just left and right turn signal. Now, a more important knob that gets used quite frequently is this knob right here on below the turn signal knob. This is the autopilot or the full self-driving knob on the Model X. So this setting sets the distance of car travel. By moving it, I could set that distance. And then by double pressing it in, then it would engage full self-driving, guys. So that is pretty much the entire car. There's not much more aside from the buttons here to control your windows and your mirrors and your child safety lock. Software updates. Now, when you come into the car, you're going to get a software update message actually on your app on your phone, like a text message and then or a notification. Then you update the software, and in the morning, it'll tell you what else is displayed. Your seat controls, everything here for heaters, your fan. You could control all the seats on the car itself from here as well as climate. You could even do camping climate. If the dog's in here, it might display a message. What's also neat is your radio controls are here. You could drag this up if you like, if you want to do Spotify, karaoke, which is pretty nice. You could sing along with it. And then other things here like a radio and so forth. Now, you also have, which is pretty cool, extra additional things here. So you got your calendar here. You could connect your phone to sync your calendar. Your camera, which will display a camera in the back, as you can see here behind me. And then you got other modes for energy. So this is pretty interesting. It's an energy, how much consumption you're doing, projected range, average, some other features that you could kind of get some data on. Charging, this is important. So Tesla doesn't recommend you charge more than 80% of your battery for every day. You could open your charge port here, but you could also set the limit of the charging you want. So if it's a trip, you want to basically be right here below, behind this line. And if you go on the trip, you just drag it. So I charge it below to maintain my battery life or longer lifespan. And then my charge, there's charging schedules and so forth. So it's pretty neat. You know, it tells you exactly what you're at as well. Same thing here. You could access that menu by pressing it here. You could access user profiles here. I have it set to my profile. If my wife wanted something different, she could have her seat adjust to her, and you can select profiles. Here you got your Wi-Fi connection settings and then your big map in between. All right, so that's kind of been the run through for all of these, but there's one feature that I'm missing. It's the entertainment feature. You could actually play games while you are driving in certain cases. It would ask that you're the passenger. And then on top of that, so your wife could play solitaire when you're driving and the other things, but there's the web and then there's the toy box. This is one of the funniest ones. There's the boombox. Your car becomes a boombox. Emissions, if you could hear this. Yeah, that was me. So it, and you could do an outside the car fart, I guess. So it just farts. And the kids love it sometimes, but then they yell at me if I do that too much. So then you got your cozy fireplace setting. This is pretty cool. If you're waiting for someone, I mean, we're in fireplace mode, guys. This is better than my living room. And this Tesla has these features. This is why I said earlier that the Range Rover is almost non-existent when it comes to quality and performance. So the fireplace mode, pretty cool. It turns on music while we're listening to it, and I like it. You could play, make beats. That's the fireplace sketchpad. So sketchpad is here. So of course I'm gonna say like plus subscribe. You know what it is. Okay, so like plus subscribe. That's my handwriting. Don't make fun of me. All right, and you could do lots of things like happy faces. The kids love this feature. You could, you know, give them eyes and so forth. And they play around with this a lot, and it's pretty cool. You could do this while driving, by the way, as well. The fireplace, for whatever reason, you cannot turn on while driving, yet you could draw. Then you got other modes. Christmas mode, your car becomes, it looks like a Santa sleigh. You're on Mars, it'll be a Mars navigation. Elon Musk wants to take everybody there. And then you got Rainbow Road, it's a rainbow lines, and then submarine mode is if you're underwater. So that's pretty much all the settings. Other settings you may want to do is you could see on this map here, you press this button and it'll give you all the charging stations near me. And when you click on a charging station, it'll take you there. But what's cool is it'll tell you how many are available. 9 available, 16, and so forth. Traffic signals, so you could turn that on or off. You could see here that it'll tell you where the traffic is. And then you have the option of going earth mode or just map mode. That's pretty much the entire screen, guys. It's nice having this additional screen. And we're gonna go into now the autopiloting mode or the driving mode of the car itself as well, okay? Okay, guys, so now we're gonna go ahead and drive and set up both autopilot and full self-driving mode. Of course, for safety, I'm going to go ahead and put on my seatbelt, and we'll go through some of the features here in the car. So obviously you have to reverse, and once you reverse, guys, this is what happens. You're getting your street behind you and so forth. So now I'm reversing, and it does give you those follow lines on the reverse as well. So it's pretty neat. There is a sound that's played, like an alien sound. Where we're gonna go today is gonna be a tire shop, because I have to fix one of these wheels. So let me put the address in here and it'll take us there somewhat. So Hayward, there we go. So this is pretty much where we're going, and it's not that far from here. It's 15 minutes, and it does look like we're gonna get on the freeway. This is pretty neat. So now the map switched, and let's get going. All right, driving the car is pretty nice. Again, it's got full driving. Here are the features of what your autopilot is, basically, you got to have a ring that pops up right here for you to do your full self-driving. Your navigation is in this screen. And I am going to go ahead and show you how that works. So if there are no lanes in your pathway, it may not turn on full self-driving. Now you see a second steering wheel popped out. I am going to go ahead and hit this button here, and it basically engaged in full self-driving. Now I need to be alert and aware, and now it is driving itself with full self-driving on. So that's what it's doing right now, and I have to hold the wheel. If I don't hold the wheel, you're going to have a message that comes up that basically says, hey, you need to hold this steering wheel, otherwise I'm not going to drive. Here's the map for you guys as well. Now it puts me into the one side, and it stops itself in front of the car in front of us. So there you go. It just stopped us at the red light. And that's kind of how full self-driving works. Detected another car that just came in here. And if another car comes by or a truck, it'll detect it here as well. Because we're behind another car, in this case, we are gonna, it's gonna take off by itself. Some downsides of having the Tesla that I've noticed. When a call comes in, this little button is too finicky. Now, they see it takes off itself. I'm not even pressing the gas or the accelerator, I should say. And now it's going. So we're driving still on full autopilot mode or full self-driving. It's detecting me in there, and we're alert and aware of what's happening. The roads are kind of bumpy here, but we're getting there. So it's a stoplight. It's pulling me up to a light. There's the stoplight. And now I'm going to turn right. I have to turn it myself. That sound means that it disconnected autopilot, and you can tell that the second steering wheel is no longer lit blue. Now we're back in it. I'll move one lane over, and I'm going to go ahead and re-engage autopilot. So now it re-engages it. It's going to center it. And with this lever, you could also set it. Do you want it to be more or less? So right now I could set it to 40, even though the speed limit is 35. There is a red light coming up, or a green light. I have to press the accelerator to confirm that I want to go through that light, even though it is green, guys. So that's kind of the thing. Now you see this beeping here. That beeping says that I have to hold on to the steering wheel, which I'm doing with my hand. And it wants to have me apply more pressure, okay? So here, we're gonna go one lane over. We need to go into the freeway, get on the freeway, as it says here, to get to the shop. This is where it gets interesting. This is where the autopilot really kicks in really well. On this side, not much here, but just navigation. So all of the fun things are happening on the little screen. Here we go, we're going on to the freeway. And we're on the freeway. And we're gonna go ahead and drive on the freeway here shortly. So now we're on the freeway. I have engaged autopilot again by double pressing or pulling that lever. And you guys could see here that the car is basically driving itself with autopilot on. Of course, I'm paying attention, holding the steering wheel and making sure that everything is going well and smooth. So that's kind of the scenario here. And it's driving itself. So, you know, you could be hands-free for a bit. Now, people have done things to get even more hands-free. They sell a weight that you could put on the steering wheel to not have to touch or hold the steering wheel every so often. I've seen people use water bottles. I don't recommend doing that at all because it's not safe. Here we go. Double press. Autopilot's engaged. I can actually hold on to the steering wheel. I'm driving in autopilot mode. I'm not even pressing on the accelerator or the brake. And it's detecting cars around me. I need to get out of this lane, so I'm gonna hit the turn signal. Watch it change lanes by itself, guys. So there it goes, it's changing lanes by itself. And Now it did that, and that's all we needed to do. So it detected that there's no car there. We can do it again. Check this out. There's a truck there, and now we're going to change lanes by itself, and that's what it did again. So now we're in front of the truck, and that's kind of the scenario here. It detects the lane change. It will keep you in lane, and it makes things a lot more comfortable. So if you are driving on a long trip on, to Lake Tahoe or anywhere you're going, it'll keep you in your lane. It detects everything, every car around it, and I find this to be the most convenient feature of it all. Some problems with the Tesla. Of course, you constantly get frozen screens, and I have to reboot it just like you saw earlier in the video. But also, I don't like the volume of the Bluetooth on the Tesla. For some reason in my car, yeah, I cannot hear someone very well. I have to turn it up to the maximum, and that's not a good thing. For whatever reason, the volume on the calls is very low, but on the audio, it's satisfactory or loud enough. What else? The answer button, because this is a scroll wheel here, when a call comes in, you get a menu similar to this, and it'll say, hey, answer the phone or not. But the scroll wheel is so finicky that oftentimes you decline the call when you're just rolling to press it to answer. I don't like that. Can't hear somebody. Not a good option. And that's pretty much it. That's a full review. I will say that I love having the Tesla. It is unlike anything that I've personally ever driven, and I've had some nice cars in my lifetime. It just makes the commute more convenient. If you guys are looking for a great commuter, having 300 plus miles ready every morning, now it's not actually 300 miles, but let's say 250, even if it says 300, it's just convenient. It gives you an opportunity to never have to go to a gas station, to never worry about if you have gas or not. There's no maintenance, there's no engine oils to change. I have 6,000 miles. I didn't even know I have 6,000 miles because I'm not worried or thinking about any of that. So, highly recommend it. Here's a train track, so it's asking me to brake. Highly recommend it, but if you're looking at something like this, you have options. You could go with a Model 3 that has all of the same functionality. You could even go with a Model Y. And these options are really neat. You don't have to get the Model X, which is the most expensive, with the Falcon doors. I think the Model Y is just as good, if not better in terms of value. So we finally got to the tire shop here. I'm going to walk in and see if they can go ahead, take this car and repair the wheel. I hope that you guys liked this video. If you did, for the full detail review, please go ahead, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. Again, the car is phenomenal in terms of technology. Probably one of the best vehicles I've ever driven. Feels great. There are some bugs. There are some things they could improve on. But overall, I would have this car over any other car out there. And in fact, I think once the Range Rover that's 120,000 leaves, I'm going to get myself a Model Y and do a review as well. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. See you guys here next video. I hope you like this review. As always, I appreciate you watching.